हेलो ऑल, वेलकम वंस अगेन टू माय इंजीनियरिंग फिजिक्स चैनल। दिस इज संजीव बढ़े फ्रॉम केजे सोमैया इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग एंड इंफॉर्मेशन टेक्नोलॉजी। फ्रॉम दिस सेशन ऑनवर्ड्स वी आर स्टार्टिंग द टॉपिक सुपर कंडक्टर्स एंड सुपर कैपेसिटर्स। इन द फर्स्ट सेशन वी विल बी इंट्रोड्यूसिंग अवर सेल्स टू सुपर कंडक्टर्स, द मीनिंग ऑफ क्रिटिकल टेम्परेचर एंड द क्रिटिकल फील्ड। Under the heading of superconductors and supercapacitors, we are going to cover these topics. But before going to the actual topics, we should be familiar with some of the prerequisites. What is electric current, flow of electric charges in metallic conductor, the meaning of drift velocity, mobility, relation of velocity and mobility with the electric current, what is Ohm's law, electrical resistance, linear and nonlinear VI characteristics, what is the meaning of resistivity and conductivity, and how the resistance depends on the temperature. So all these things we will discuss as prerequisites. Some of these things we have already discussed in the topic called semiconductor physics. So we'll just revise in brief before starting the superconductors topic. Then in superconductors, we will first define what is superconductor, what is critical temperature, critical magnetic field. Then we will get introduced to the effect which is called as Meissner's effect. Then we will discuss types of superconductors, type 1 superconductor, type 2 superconductor. We will get introduced to high TC superconductors, the superconductors which are having high critical temperature. Then we will go to the supercapacitors. We will discuss principle and working of supercapacitors, construction of supercapacitors, which materials are used, and what are the applications of supercapacitors. And then we will compare the supercapacitors with capacitor and batteries on the basis of energy density and power density. Outcome of this topic will be, after learning this module, a student will be able to discuss the properties of superconductors and supercapacitors to apply them in novel applications. Number of lectures needed will be 2 or 3, and marks weightage is around 8 to 10. In a solid, the charge carriers are in a state of random motion. At room temperature, the thermal motion of an individual electron may be visualized as random scattering from lattice atoms, impurities, and other electrons. So you can see the electrons, charge carriers, are moving randomly. Some are moving in this direction, some are moving in this direction, some are moving in this direction. At thermal equilibrium, the net current due to this randomly moving charge carriers, randomly moving electrons, will be zero. Now when we apply electric field across this conductor, under the influence of electric field, each of these electrons will experience a force F bar in the direction opposite to the direction of electric field. So here the electric field is acting in this direction, and the force on the electrons will act in the opposite direction, because force is equal to E minus E into E. So this will result in net motion of group of electrons in the direction opposite to the direction of electric field. So electrons will start moving in the direction opposite to the direction of electric field. In addition to this, random motion of electrons will also be there, but the net motion of group of electrons will be in the direction opposite to the direction of electric field. This net motion of electrons in a particular direction under the influence of electric field is called as drift motion. So electrons are drifted in a particular direction because force F is acting on them. The current due to this motion is called as drift current. So we can define drift current as the current caused by the electrons moving in a particular direction under the influence of electric field. So drift current is defined as the current obtained due to the motion of electrons in a particular direction under the influence of electric field. So we have seen the meaning of drift current. Drift current is the current obtained under the influence of electric field. Now drift current density is defined as the drift current per unit cross-sectional area of the conductor. So drift current density is defined as drift current per unit area of cross-section of the conductor. It is denoted by J, and we can write this J to be equal to I upon A. current per unit area of cross section of the conductor. J is equal to I upon A, so it can be measured as ampere per meter. Let us call this equation number 1. Now, electric field can be defined as the potential drop per unit length of the conductor. So, by definition, we can write electric field E to be equal to minus dV by dx. Now, if V is the potential difference and L is the length of the conductor, we can write E to be equal to V upon L. The electric field can be measured as volts per meter. Unit for potential drop is volts and for length it is meter. So, volts per meter, we can measure the electric field. Let us call this as equation number 2. Now, as the current flows, there will be some opposition to the flow of current. Current flows means electrons are drifted in a particular direction, but some of the electrons may be scattered by the lattice atoms, and this will cause the opposition to the flow of current. So, this opposition to the flow of current is called as resistance. And resistance offered by the conductor of unit length and unit cross-sectional area is called as resistivity. Now, this resistivity can be defined as resistance offered by the conductor of unit length and unit cross-sectional area. So, we can write it as R into A upon L, resistance offered by the conductor having unit length and unit cross-sectional area. This resistivity can be measured in terms of ohm meter. Unit for area is meter square, unit for length is meter. So, meter square upon meter, that will be meter. The unit for resistance is ohm. So, resistivity is measured as ohm meter. Conductivity is defined as reciprocal of the resistivity. So, we can write conductivity to be equal to 1 upon resistivity, that is equal to L upon RA in this case. Conductivity can be measured as per ohm meter. Let us call this as equation number 4. Now, if you take the product of equation number 2 and equation number 4, we can write conductivity into electric field to be equal to L upon RA into V upon L. So, this LL can be cancelled, and we can write this product as V upon R into 1 upon A. V upon R is equal to I, that is the drift current. So, we get the product of conductivity and electric field to be equal to I upon A, and I upon A from this equation number 1 is nothing but drift current density, which can be written as J. So, we can write from this the drift current density J to be equal to conductivity into electric field. So, this is one important relation that we have got, which we will be using in our further discussion. So, drift current density is product of conductivity and electric field. When we apply the electric field across the conductor, the charge carriers in the conductor will be drifted in a particular direction due to the force that is acting on them due to the electric field. The force will be equal to the product of charge on the charge carrier and the intensity of electric field. So, if the charge carriers are electrons, then electrons will be drifted in the direction opposite to the direction of electric field. Electrons are drifted means they will move in the direction opposite to the direction of electric field. So, as the electrons are moving, they will acquire the velocity. And drift velocity is defined as the velocity acquired by the electrons under the influence of electric field. Velocity is nothing but displacement per unit time. So, drift velocity is defined as the net displacement in electron position per unit time under the influence of electric field. So, drift velocity will be the velocity measured under the influence of electric field. Now, we can define mobility of electrons as the average drift velocity acquired by electrons per unit electric field. So, if you apply electric field of 1 volt per meter across the conductor, whatever velocity acquired by the charge carriers will be the mobility of charge carriers. Okay, so mobility of electrons is defined as the average drift velocity acquired by electrons per unit electric field. So we can write the relation for mobility as mobility mu is equal to V upon E, where V is average drift velocity acquired by electrons and E is the electric field applied. In earlier discussion, we have shown that drift current density is the product of conductivity and electric field. And we have also defined mobility as the average drift velocity acquired by the electrons under the influence of unit electric field. So mobility can be written as, mobility of electrons can be written as V upon E. So let us call these as equation number 1 and equation number 2. And these equations we will use now to get the relation between conductivity and mobility. So in this slide, we will try to get the relation between conductivity and mobility using these two equations. So for that, let us consider a conductor in which current I is flowing. So current I will be obtained due to the electrons moving in the direction opposite to the direction of electric field. Let V be the drift velocity of the electrons. So if V is the drift velocity of the electrons, that means length travelled by the electrons per unit time will be equal to V. If V is the velocity with which the electrons are moving, the length travelled by the electrons in unit time will be equal to V. So if V is the length travelled by the electrons in unit time and A is area of cross section of the conductor, then volume swept by the electrons in unit time will be equal to V into A. If V into A is the volume swept by the electrons per unit time, and if N is the number of electrons per unit volume, that is N is electron concentration, then number of electrons moving in this volume VA will be equal to NVA. And if E is charge on each electron, then the charge flowing per unit time, charge moving per unit time will be equal to NEVA, that is number of electrons moving per unit time multiplied by charge on each electron. And charge flowing per unit time is nothing but current, and therefore we can write the relation for current as NEVA, where N is electron concentration, E is charge on the electron, V is drift velocity of the electrons, and A is area of cross section of the conductor. So from this relation, we can write the relation for drift current density, which is written as I upon A. So current is obtained as NEVA. So current density can be written as NEVA upon A. AA will get cancelled, and we can write the relation for current density J to be equal to NEV. Now from equation number 1 and equation number 2, we can write conductivity to be equal to drift current density upon electric field. From equation number 1, we can write conductivity to be equal to drift current density upon electric field. Here J is equal to NEV, drift current density is equal to NEV, we have just now found out, and mobility is equal to V upon E. Mobility is equal to V upon E. So just put V upon E to be equal to mobility, and we can write conductivity to be equal to NE mu. So conductivity is equal to NE mu is the required relation between conductivity and mobility. So we have got the relation between conductivity and mobility. Conductivity is given by product of electron concentration, charge on electron, and mobility of electrons. You all must be familiar with the Ohm's law. Ohm's law states that the current through a conductor between two points is directly proportional to the voltage across two points, provided the temperature and the other physical conditions remain unchanged. So current is directly proportional to voltage. By introducing the constant of proportionality R, which is called as resistance, we can write I is equal to V upon R, or V is equal to I into R. Here I is the current through the conductor in the units of ampere, V is the voltage measured across the conductor in the units of volt, and R is the resistance of the conductor in the units of ohm. So according to Ohm's law, this R resistance in the relation is a constant. So if we plot a graph of IV characteristics, graph of current versus voltage, then the graph will look like this. It will be a linear graph. As the voltage changes, current will also change in proportion with voltage. But some devices like semiconductor diodes do not obey Ohm's law. Do not obey Ohm's law means IV characteristics for such devices will not be linear. So non-linear IV characteristics means Ohm's law is not obeyed. So here you can see resistance is not constant. At different points, the resistance will be different. So these are the non-linear IV characteristics of PN junction diode when it is connected in the forward bias mode. Let us now understand the temperature dependence of resistivity. In case of metal, the temperature increases with the increasing resistance. As the temperature increases, the resistance also increases. So metal has positive temperature coefficient. Now, in order to understand why this resistance increases with the increasing temperature, we need to know the mechanism behind the resistance. In the metal, electrons are loosely bound to the atoms. So as the electrons get a little amount of energy, they become free to move. As the electrons leave the atom, positively charged ion cores are left behind. These positively charged ion cores continuously vibrate about their mean positions, and these vibrations are called as lattice vibrations, also called as phonons. The electrons are in a state of random motion inside the metal. When we apply electric field, there is a direction to the flow of electrons, and electrons start moving in the direction opposite to the direction of electric field due to the electric force F acting on them. As these electrons move in the direction opposite to the direction of electric field, they will collide with the vibrating ions. So this collision may change the direction of the electrons. So this is called as electron scattering. And this electron scattering is the main reason behind the resistance, opposition to the flow of current. As more electrons are scattered, less electrons will reach the other end, resulting into more resistance. As we increase the temperature, the amplitude of these lattice vibrations will also increase. And as the amplitude of these lattice vibrations increase, there is a more chance that electron will collide with these vibrating ions and will get scattered. So with increase in temperature, electron scattering is more, and as a result of this, less number of electrons will reach the other end. That means resistance will increase. So in case of metals, with the increase in temperature, resistance increases. And therefore we say metal has got a positive temperature coefficient. As the temperature increases, resistance also increases. So in case of metals, as far as the resistance is concerned, this interaction of the electron with the vibrating ions is very important. So this is called as electron-phonon interaction. So this electron-phonon interaction is the important reason behind the resistance. More is the electron-phonon interaction, more will be the resistance offered. Now in case of semiconductors, the resistivity decreases with increasing temperature. Now in case of semiconductors, we have got a valence band which is completely filled and conduction band which is completely empty. As the electrons in the valence band get sufficient energy, they can jump to the conduction band, leaving behind holes inside the valence band. This conduction band electrons contribute to the current, and the holes created in the valence band will also contribute to the current. Now what happens in semiconductors with increase in temperature? As the temperature increases, more and more electrons in the valence band will get sufficient energy to go to the conduction band. So with the increase in temperature, more electrons will be available in the conduction band and more number of holes will be available in the valence band. As a result of this, in case of semiconductor, as the temperature increases, conductivity will increase and therefore resistivity will decrease. So in semiconductors, resistivity decreases with the increasing temperature, and therefore we say in semiconductors, temperature coefficient is negative. So with this background, now we can define what is superconductivity. We know that at room temperature, the resistivity of metal is of the order of 10 raised to minus 8 ohm meter. And metals have positive temperature coefficient, that is, their resistance increases with increasing temperature. As we decrease the temperature, the resistance of the metals will also decrease. But it will never reach the zero value. However, K. Ohms in 1911, when he was doing some experiment with pure mercury, he found that the resistance of mercury suddenly drops to zero at around 4 degree Kelvin. He concluded from this experiment that mercury has passed into a new state which is called as superconducting state, in which the resistance becomes zero. So meaning of superconductivity is zero resistance. So in some materials like mercury, it is observed that resistivity suddenly drops to zero at a particular temperature. Such substances or such materials are called as superconductors. And the temperature at which the resistivity of the material drops to zero is called as transition temperature or critical temperature. It is denoted by TC. So for mercury, it is found by K. Ohms in 1911 that this critical temperature is around 4 degree Kelvin. So what is superconductivity? Superconductivity means the state of zero resistance, and the temperature at which this zero resistance is obtained is called as critical temperature. Here we have mentioned critical temperature for some of the substances. Elements like tungsten has got critical temperature of 0.01 degree Kelvin, cadmium has 0.56 degree Kelvin, aluminium turns into superconducting state at 1.19 degree Kelvin, mercury has got 4.15 degree Kelvin, niobium 9.46 degree Kelvin. Compounds like ZrAl2 0.3 degree Kelvin, AuBe 2.64 degree Kelvin, NiBi 4.25 degree Kelvin, NB3Al 17.5 degree Kelvin, and NB3 has got the critical temperature of 18.05 degree Kelvin. Superconductivity was discovered in 1911 by K. Ohms, but the theory explaining this superconductivity phenomenon was available in 1957. This long delay in development of the theory indicates how difficult it was to formulate the theory explaining the superconductivity phenomenon. John Bardeen, Leon Cooper and J. Robert Schrieffer put forward their theory, which is known as BCS theory, to explain the superconductivity phenomenon. According to BCS theory, the superconductivity arises from a subtle interaction between free electrons and lattice vibrations, that is phonons. So the main reason according to BCS theory behind the superconductivity is electron-phonon interaction. To arrive at this statement, Bardeen, Cooper and Schrieffer used some of the observations. One observation was, very good conductors at room temperature such as copper, silver, gold do not turn out to be superconductors even at very very low temperatures. But some poor conductors like lead, niobium at room temperature may exhibit the superconductivity when taken to the very low temperatures. So poor conductors get transformed into the superconducting state easily, and good conductors at room temperature, it is not possible to transfer them into the superconducting state. So we know the poor conductors at room temperature means higher electron phonon scattering, because electron phonon scattering is the main reason behind the resistance, higher value of the resistance. So poor conductors get transformed into the superconducting state at low temperature. Poor conductor means higher electron phonon scattering, strong electron phonon scattering, and therefore this electron phonon scattering has something to do with the superconducting phenomenon. Metals which are good conductors means the electron phonon scattering is comparatively less in case of metals. They do not get transformed into the superconducting state. Poor conductors are transformed into the superconducting state. So Bardeen, Cooper and Schrieffer from this commented that this electron phonon scattering must have something to do superconductivity. Another important observation considered by Bardeen, Cooper and Schrieffer was that varying the relative abundance of different isotopes has an effect on the critical temperature. Isotope means what? Isotope means nuclides having identical nuclear charge but different nuclear mass. It was found by them that samples with lighter nuclei, that means fewer neutrons, will have higher value of critical temperature. A smaller nuclear mass means larger amplitude of lattice vibrations. So smaller the mass means larger will be the amplitude of lattice vibrations, and therefore greater will be the electron phonon scattering. Because larger the amplitude means more is the chance for the electron to get collide with these vibrating ions, and therefore more will be the chance of scattering. Smaller the amplitude, less will be the chance of electron getting scattered. So smaller nuclear mass means larger amplitude of the lattice vibrations and hence greater electron phonon scattering. And what Bardeen, Cooper and Schrieffer observed, they observed that samples having smaller nuclear mass, that means lighter nuclei, have higher critical temperature. Means it is easier to transform the isotopes having smaller nuclear mass into superconducting state. So the isotope effect is another evidence which indicates the relation of superconductivity with the electron phonon interaction. So from these two important observations, the poor conductors have more chance to get converted into the superconducting state, and samples with lighter nuclei have higher value of the critical temperature. Bardeen, Cooper and Schrieffer arrived at the statement that the superconductivity arises from a subtle interaction between conduction electrons, that is free electrons, and the lattice vibrations, that is phonons. So electron phonon scattering, if it is high, then there is more chance that the material will get transformed into the superconducting state. Greater the electron phonon scattering, more is the chance of the material getting transformed into the superconducting state. So according to Bardeen, Cooper and Schrieffer, electron phonon interaction has something to do with the superconductivity. As the temperature increases due to the increased amplitude of these lattice vibrations, the electron phonon scattering also increases, and that leads to increase in resistance. Now let us see what happens when we reduce the temperature below the critical temperature. When the temperature is reduced below the critical temperature, the thermal energy associated with these lattice vibrations will be very small, and as a result of this, the amplitude of the vibrations will also be small. When the electron enters in this lattice, due to the attractive force between the electron and this positively charged ions, these positively charged ions are pulled towards the electrons, and this results in a positive region, a strong positive region created over here. The attraction of these electrons to the wake of positive region is greater than the electron-electron Coulomb repulsion, and the two electrons form a bound pair, and this bound pair is called as the Cooper pair. So now, once the temperature is less than critical temperatures, electrons will not move individually alone, but they will travel in the form of the pair. Once the Cooper pair is formed, lattice vibrations cannot scatter this pair of electrons easily. Lattice vibrations can scatter this pair of electrons only by breaking that pair, and this will require energy Eg equal to 3.5 KTC, where Eg is the binding energy for this Cooper pair. And we have reduced the temperature below the critical temperature, and as the temperature is less than the critical temperature, the thermal energies associated with this lattice vibrations will not be sufficient to do this, will not be sufficient to break the Cooper pair, and therefore Cooper pair will move undeviated, unscattered. Cooper pair cannot be scattered by the lattice vibrations at the temperature less than the critical temperature, and therefore resistivity will become zero. All the electrons moving from one end to the other end will reach the other end. Electrons in good conductors like gold, silver move so freely in this lattice that little electron lattice interaction take place. So the electron phonon interaction is very less in good conductors, and therefore there will be no pairing of electrons, because pairing of electrons requires strong electron phonon interaction, and therefore this good conductors at room temperature do not show the superconductivity even at very low temperatures. So this is how Bardeen, Cooper and Schrieffer explained the superconductivity phenomenon, and this theory is called as BCS theory. If we keep the superconductor in the external magnetic field, then it is observed that superconductivity vanishes if sufficiently strong magnetic field is applied. The minimum magnetic field required to destroy the superconducting state of the specimen and restore the normal conducting state is called as critical field. This critical field is denoted by HC, and this critical field is a function of temperature. The critical field at temperature T is given by HC of T equal to H naught into bracket 1 minus T by TC square, where H naught is the critical field at 0 degree Kelvin. The temperature dependence of critical field is shown in this graph. So this is HC of T versus T graph. This is H naught, the critical field at T is equal to 0 degree Kelvin. So the superconductor will behave as a superconductor only till the external magnetic field is less than the critical magnetic field. Once the magnetic field becomes greater than critical magnetic field, the superconducting will get transformed into the normal state. Now this relation HC of T is equal to H naught into bracket 1 minus T by TC the square. This relation can be used to solve different type of problems. So let us solve some numerical problems based on this relation. A superconducting tin has a critical temperature of 3.7 Kelvin at zero magnetic field and a critical field of 0.0306 Tesla at 0 degree Kelvin. Find the critical field at 2 degree Kelvin. So here critical temperature is given as 3.7 degree Kelvin. H naught, that is the critical field at 0 degree Kelvin, is 0.0306 Tesla. We are asked to find out the critical magnetic field at temperature equal to 2 degree Kelvin. So we can use this relation HC of T, which is equal to H naught into bracket 1 minus T by TC square. So critical field depends on the value of T. It is a function of temperature T. So the relation for critical field at temperature T is HC of T equal to H naught into bracket 1 minus T by TC the square. Here H naught is given to us, the critical field at 0 degree Kelvin, 0.0306 Tesla. T temperature is given to us 2 degree Kelvin and TC is 3.7 degree Kelvin. So by substituting these values, we can calculate the critical field at 2 degree Kelvin as 0.0216 Tesla. So as the temperature increases, the critical field reduces. The superconducting transition temperature of lead is 7.26 Kelvin. The initial field at 0 degree Kelvin is 64 into 10 raised to 3 ampere per meter. Calculate the critical field at 5 Kelvin. So here at 0 degree Kelvin, the critical field is given as 64 into 10 raised to 3 ampere per meter. So that is H naught. Critical temperature is 7.26 Kelvin. We are asked to find out critical field at temperature 5 degree Kelvin. So again, we can use this relation, Hc of T equal to H naught into bracket 1 minus T by Tc square. H naught is given to us, critical field at 0 degree Kelvin. T is 5 degree Kelvin. Critical temperature Tc is 7.26 degree Kelvin. And therefore, we can calculate the critical temperature at 5 degree Kelvin as 33.64 into 10 raised to 3 ampere per meter. Critical field of niobium is 10 raised to 5 ampere per meter at 8 degree Kelvin and 2 into 10 raised to 5 at 0 degree Kelvin. Calculate critical temperature of niobium. So here in this problem, the critical field at 8 degree Kelvin is given as 10 raised to 5 ampere per meter. And critical field at 0 degree Kelvin is given as 2 into 10 raised to 5 ampere per meter. And we are asked to find out critical temperature. So this relation of Hc of T, which is equal to H naught into bracket 1 minus T by Tc square, we will have to write to get the value of Tc. So we'll just rearrange the terms. This H naught is taken on the other side. So we'll get 1 minus T by Tc square equal to Hc of T upon H naught. Again, this 1 is taken to the other side. So we can write T by Tc square equal to 1 minus Hc of T upon H naught. So T square will be equal to 1 minus Hc of T upon H naught into Tc square. And therefore, Tc can be written as T upon square root of 1 minus Hc of T upon H naught. So now we have T as 8 degree Kelvin, Hc of T as 10 raised to 5 ampere per meter, and H naught is 2 into 10 raised to 5 ampere per meter. So by substituting all these values, we can calculate the critical temperature of niobium as 11.31 degree Kelvin. Critical temperature of a superconductor when no magnetic field is applied is Tc. Find the temperature at which the critical field becomes half of its value at 0 degree Kelvin. So it is given to us that Hc of T is equal to H naught by 2 at temperature T. So at temperature T, the critical field becomes half of its value at 0 degree Kelvin. The value of critical field at 0 degree Kelvin is H naught. So we know the relation for Hc of T. Hc of T is given by Hc of T is equal to H naught upon 1 minus T by Tc the square. So we can rearrange the terms to get the relation for T, because we are asked to find out temperature at which the critical field becomes half of its value at 0 degree Kelvin. So we need to get the relation for T. So just rearrange these terms. 1 minus T by Tc square equal to Hc of T upon H naught. So this H naught is taken to the other side. Then this 1 will be taken to the other side. So T by Tc square is equal to 1 minus Hc of T upon H naught. Then when we take Tc on the other side, T square is equal to 1 minus Hc of T upon H naught Tc square. And therefore, T is equal to square root of 1 minus Hc of T upon H naught into Tc. So just take square root of this right hand side. Now Hc of T is given as H naught upon 2. So let us put Hc of T is equal to H naught upon 2. So H naught will get cancelled. This will become 1 minus 1 by 2, that is square root of 5. So the temperature at which critical field becomes half of its value at 0 degree Kelvin will be square root of 0.5 Tc, that is equal to 0.707 Tc. Here the value of Tc is not given, so we will write the temperature as multiple of this Tc only. The transition temperature for lead is 7.2 degree Kelvin. However, at 5 degree Kelvin, it loses the superconducting property if subjected to the magnetic field of 3.3 into 10 raised to 4 ampere per meter. Find the maximum value of H which will allow the metal to retain its superconductivity at 0 degree Kelvin. So here Hc of T is given. The critical field at temperature 5 degree Kelvin is given as 3.3 into 10 raised to 4 ampere per meter. Critical temperature is also given, 7.2 degree Kelvin, and we are asked to find out critical field at 0 degree Kelvin. So H naught is what we want to find now. We know the relation for Hc of T. Hc of T is equal to H naught into bracket 1 minus T by Tc the square. So we can just rearrange this in order to get the relation for H naught. So H naught will be equal to Hc of T upon 1 minus T by Tc the square. So just this term is taken to the other side. Hc of T is given as 3.3 into 10 raised to 4, T is 5 degree Kelvin, and Tc critical temperature is 7.2 degree Kelvin. So by substituting these values, we can calculate the critical field at 0 degree Kelvin, which will be required to retain the superconductivity. So this H naught is calculated here as 6.37 into 10 raised to 4 ampere per meter. A long thin superconducting wire of metal produces a magnetic field 105 into 10 raised to 3 ampere per meter on its surface due to the current through it at a certain temperature T. The critical field of the metal is 150 into 10 raised to 3 ampere per meter at absolute zero. The critical temperature Tc of the metal is 9.2 Kelvin. What is the value of T? What is the value of the temperature? So we are asked to find temperature here. Hc of T is given as 105 into 10 raised to 3 ampere per meter. Critical temperature is given as 9.2 degree Kelvin. And critical field at 0 degree Kelvin, absolute zero temperature, is given as 150 into 10 raised to 3 ampere per meter. We are asked to find out T. We know the relation for Hc of T. Hc of T is equal to H naught into bracket 1 minus T by Tc square. We'll rearrange the terms to get the relation for T. So 1 minus T by Tc square will be equal to Hc of T upon H naught. This H naught is taken to the other side. So we can write the relation for T by Tc square equal to 1 by minus Hc of T by H naught. This 1 is taken to the other side. Then we can take this Tc to the other side. So T will be equal to square root of 1 minus Hc of T upon H naught into Tc. And therefore, by substituting the values of Hc of T, H naught and Tc, we can calculate the value of temperature T. So T in this case is obtained as 5.06 degree Kelvin. So we are at the end of session number 1 on superconductors and supercapacitors. In this session, we got introduced ourselves to the superconductivity. We studied the meaning of critical temperature and critical field. We also discussed BCS theory that explains the superconductivity phenomenon. In the coming sessions, we'll be discussing Meissner effect, type of superconductors and high Tc superconductors. And there will be one last session for supercapacitors. I hope you must have enjoyed this session. If you like this session, then please subscribe to the channel so that you will get timely intimation of new videos uploaded to the channel. If you have any doubts, if you have any queries, then please feel free to contact me. Thank you. Thank you once again.